Welcome to Pilgrim's Progress. I'm Ray Greenleaf, pastor of the National Prayer Chapel. We're going to go back today and take another look at a portion of the Pilgrim's Progress, that wonderful allegory written by John Bunyan back in the 1600s. The book that I'm going to be sharing from is edited by C.J. Lovick. We're going to read briefly about the work of grace. The work of grace is made known as follows: by a confession of his faith in Christ. Number two, by a life that is answerable to that confession. To be specific, a life of holiness, heart holiness, family holiness. If he has a family, it has to be a holy family. And by life and conversation that is sharply distinguished from the world. Such a man inwardly abhors both his sins and himself as a sinner. He suppresses sin in his family, and he promotes holiness in the world. He does not do this by talk only, as a hypocrite or a talkative person, but rather by being a practical demonstration of a godly life in faith and love and through the power of the Word. Now, if you have no objection to this brief description of the work of grace and how it's evidencing itself in the life of a true believer, then I will ask you a second question. Talkative, calmly stated, my part is not to object, but to listen. Let me hear your second question. Faithful went on. It is this: have you experienced what I have described? Does your life and your conduct testify and prove the grace of God? Or does your religion consist of words only, without deeds to attest to the truth of them? Please, if you want to answer me, be careful to say no more than what you know God above will approve, and say amen to. Say nothing but what your conscience will agree to. For it is not the one who commends himself who is approved, but the one whom the Lord commends. Besides, it is great wickedness to say, I am such and such, when my conduct and all my neighbors say completely different. Then Talkative began to blush, but quickly recovered, and said, you talk now about experience and the consciousness of God. You appeal to him for justification of what is spoken. This is not the kind of discourse I expected, nor am I disposed to give an answer to such questions, nor do I feel obligated to answer unless you are taking the job of the catechism teacher. Even if that is how you see yourself, I refuse to allow you to become my judge. But I would be interested in why you ask me such questions. Faithful responded, because you were so anxious to talk, and because I wanted to know if there was anything to back up your talk besides talk alone. Also, to tell you the whole of it, I have heard about you. They say that you are a man whose religion is only talk, and that your conduct is at odds with what your profession is from your mouth. They say you are a blemish among Christians, and that true religion gets a bad reputation because of your ungodly conduct. I have heard that some have already stumbled because of your wicked ways, and that even more are in danger of being destroyed by your example. Since you are ready to listen to the reports of others and to make rash judgments, I conclude that you are a spiteful, or melancholy man and not a fit partner for discussion. And so goodbye. And Christian came beside Faithful and said to his brother in faith, I told you how it would happen. Your words and his lusts could not agree. He would rather leave your company than reform his life. So let him go. So let him go. These are hard words. These are difficult issues. As I was reading this again and just reviewing it, the question was so vital. How does the saving grace of God make itself known in your heart? I ask you that question today. How does the saving grace of God make itself known in your heart? And have you experienced what I'm talking about? And does your life and does your conduct testify that Jesus Christ dwells in you? Or does your religion consist in words only? Are you Mr. or Mrs. Talkative? You say the right words, but you don't live them. You see, grace causes the soul to hate its sin. Grace produces conviction of sin. It produces shame in the heart of a person, and it gives a revelation of Jesus Christ. It causes one to enter into a confession that Jesus is Lord. So, does the saving grace of God make itself known in your heart? Is there conviction of sin in your heart? Do you have shame in your heart for your sin? If not, according to John Bunyan, who was a Reformed Baptist, you're not saved. You're still playing in the world. You may call yourself a Christian, but let's be straight up. If you're still walking in sin, then grace is not working in your heart. Because once grace begins to work in your heart, there is conviction of sin, and there is the power by the blood of Jesus to utterly reject that sin and to walk away from it. And that's why the second question is so important. Does your life and your conduct actually testify or prove your claim of God's grace operating in your life? Or does your religion consist of words only? Now, somewhere, we have to come to terms with this. And this is a terrifying question for me. Because as I come to this broadcast, I confront you, I share the gospel with you, I call you to follow Jesus, but many of you just turn aside as though, okay, I listened to a pretty song, and there's no action response on your part. There has to be an action response for the grace of God to be real in your heart. Is the grace of God functioning in your heart? Some of you are going to say, oh, it is, because it covers me. Well, the grace of God in Scripture, according to Titus, is not a blanket that covers your sin. Rather, it uncovers your sin. It makes apparent your distance from Jesus. If grace comes into your life and it doesn't do that, It's false grace. It's cheap grace. It's greasy grace. It's not real grace. It's the devil's grace. And many of you listening to this broadcast are walking under the devil's grace because you're able to say, I'm a follower of Jesus Christ, and yet you love the world, and you love the entertainment of the world, and you love the things of the world, you love the money of the world, the ambition of the world, the uncleanness of the world, and yet you say, I'm in God's grace. You're not in God's grace, you're in the devil's grace. And that's not saving grace. That's hell-bound grace. I mean, let's be real. There has to be some objective reality about this gospel walk. Do the arrows of conviction pierce your heart? Are you making real progress toward the kingdom of God? Are you engaged? Are you building the kingdom of God? Are you building your kingdom of darkness? When I come back to this story of Moses, this morning early I was in the prayer closet, weeping before God. Because God came and he appeared on the mountain, lightning and thunder and wind and hail terrified the people. And he called Moses up into the mountain and he wanted to have Moses spend 40 days with him talking about what was really on God's heart. Now please just stop for a minute. God came and spent 40 days. God has a universe to run. God probably has many universes to run. He has many places he can be and many things he wants to do. But he came and for 40 days talked with Moses because he wanted to prepare a bride. And he wanted to move down in the middle of the camp in a tabernacle. And so he gave Moses the directions for how to build that tabernacle, what the furniture was going to look like, and every detail was minutely laid out because this was God's house. And while he's there talking with Moses about moving down among the people so he can be with his people, the love of his heart, they're playing the prostitute with the prosperity gods, the calf gods of Egypt. Makes me weep because I recognize those times when I've done the same thing. When God's been trying to talk about intimacy and closeness and I have chosen to trash the heart of God. And I've turned to some crazy thing, some foolish thing, and numbed my mind out instead of going to the lover of my soul and entrusting myself to him. This morning I was going over that with the Lord and telling him, please, I'm sorry. I have done that. I won't do it again. Have you trashed God's love for you? Rejected his grace and his mercy? Been full of yourself? Only thought about you and not about how God was feeling about you? You understand, God has feelings. He's a person. And now he's a human person. Jesus is God. He has feelings like we have feelings. He has desires, even as we have desires. He's real. He loves us. And and I have many times turned aside and comforted my heart with some foolishness, numbing out, vegging out, instead of turning to the lover of my soul. Have you done that? Have you turned to some worldly pursuit, some worldly enjoyment, some worldly pleasure, and just turned your back on the living God of heaven? That's what the children of Israel did. So God sent Moses back off the mountain, down to talk with the people, confront them with their sin. Judgment came upon the camp. Quite a few people died. And then the Lord said to Moses, "Leave this place, you and the people you brought up out of Egypt, and go up to the land I promised on oath to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, saying, 'I will give it to your descendants.' I will send an angel before you and drive out the Canaanites and the Amorites and the Hittites and the Perizzites and the Hivites and the Jebusites. Go up to the land flowing with milk and honey, but I will not go with you because you are a stiff-necked people and I might destroy you on the way." Now, please, don't miss this. God is telling the children of Israel to leave Mount Sinai and to go to the land that he has chosen for them. And he's saying, "I'm not going to go with you." If you look carefully at how this is written in the scripture, it's obvious they had not yet spent a year there building the tabernacle. So God is saying, "I'm not going to put my tabernacle in the midst of you. I have changed my mind. I'm going to send you on to the promised land. Go ahead, leave. I'm not going to go with you. I'm going to stay here on the mountain." Well, look at what happens then. It says that Moses, in verse 7 of chapter 3, used to take a tent and pitch it outside the camp, some distance away, calling it the tent of meeting. And anyone inquiring of the Lord would go to the tent of meeting outside the camp. And whenever Moses went to the tent, all the people rose and stood at the entrances to their tents, watching Moses until he entered the tent. As Moses went into the tent, the pillar of cloud would come down and stay at the entrance while the Lord spoke with Moses. Whenever the people saw the pillar of cloud standing at the entrance to the tent, they all stood and worshipped, each at the entrance of his tent. And the Lord would speak to Moses face to face, as a man speaks with his friend. And then Moses would return to the camp, but his young aide Joshua, son of Nun, did not leave the tent. I want you to get the picture. God wants to move into their camp, right into the middle of it. But because of their sin at Mount Sinai, God is now saying, "I'm not going to move into your camp. I'm sending you alone without my presence." Moses then goes outside of the camp to a tent because God would not come into their camp. Moses had to leave the whole encampment and go to a tent outside the camp because the entire encampment was too wicked and God would not come into their presence. I am terrified today that most churches in America, the camp of God's people, he will not enter because of their sin. Oh, they can have the best choirs and the best orchestras. They can have the finest speakers. They can have all the community programs. They can have the rock and roll go-go church. They can have the city of praise. The presence of God won't enter the place. It's a haunt of demons. because there is sin in the camp. One church that I was intimately aware of, the pastor was having an affair with one of the staff members. Everyone knew it. No one would confront. The wife was angry. She made her husband often sleep at the church in the office, so he kept a suitcase of clothes in the office because he couldn't go home. His wife was too angry with him for playing around with his associate pastor. He would not repent. Then he began to drink and get drunk. This is the church where revival moved in real power once. But now the presence of God was absent. It was gone. This was a church of many hundreds of people. Before I knew all of this, the man and his wife came to my home for dinner one night. I said to him, "Every time I drive by your church building, I pray for you for revival." He said, "Oh, Pastor Ray, do not pray for me to have revival. I don't want revival." I couldn't understand why. Ichabod was written over his church. A short time later, he died of a heart attack. No one dealt with the issue. New pastor came in. I said to that new pastor, "You have to clean up this mess." He said, "Ray, I can't do that. The church is already too divided. If I dealt with it, I'd lose half the membership." After a little over a year, he had lost more than half of the membership. Last I heard, that church was down to about 30 members. Ichabod was written on it. Other churches continue to prosper in the worldly way, continue to teach that you can sin and be a Christian, continue to walk in the ways of the world, continue to enjoy the programming of the world. It's a social church, and it seems to prosper, grows in numbers, builds large buildings. But the presence of God is not in the house. The presence of God is not in the house. When I go to meet with the body of Christ, and to me it's the most important single thing I do in my life, is I go to meet with the people of God. I'm very aware as I go to meet with the people of God that it will be a useless time if the Spirit of God is not present among us. If he does not bring conviction of sin, then he is not there. The sign of the Holy Spirit is conviction of sin, not speaking in tongues. Oh, tongues is one of the gifts, as is prophecy and administration and discernment. I believe all of those gifts are for us today, but the gift of the Holy Spirit is conviction of sin, turning to righteousness, causing our hearts to desire Jesus. Is the Holy Spirit working in your heart today? Is there a hunger in your soul? Is there a panting of your heart after God? Or are you caught in the hardness of sin and wickedness? Jesus came to save his people from their sin. He came to save you. Will you let him do that? Will you let him save you? Or are you just Mr. Talkative or Mrs. Talkative? You talk a good talk, but walk in wickedness. And there's no evidence in your life of the mighty power of the Holy Spirit. So here's Moses. He's gone outside of the camp because that's the only place God will come. And God talks with Moses. Moses said to the Lord, "You've been telling me, lead these people, but you've not let me know whom you will send with me. You said, I know you by name, and you have found favor with me. If you are pleased with me, teach me your ways, so that I may know you and continue to find favor with you." If you are pleased with me. Is God pleased with you today? Do you know in your heart? Is God pleased with you today? Is your life a demonstration of the ways of God? Is your life filled with holiness today? Is your life filled with the joy and peace and love of Jesus today? Or does Jesus refuse to come into your house because of the uncleanness in your house? Our phone number is 877-534-0780. Is Jesus pleased with you today? If he is, call and share how you know he's pleased with you. If he's not pleased with you, call and share with me why God is not pleased with you. What have you done? How have you hardened your heart? Am I talking to you about real things? Do you understand what I'm saying to you today? Or are you just going to listen and walk away? When was the last time you spent all night in prayer? When was the last time you sought after the Lord with all your heart? Some of you are so far away from the Lord that if you had a desperate need, you'd die before you could get to him. Some of you are several months' travel away from the Lord, caught in your busyness and your worldly life with some sentimental deal about Jesus. But you're so far from him, you'd never reach him in time for him to save your life. How is it with your heart today? Are you a religious person? Are you a religious person but not a holy person? Do you know the ways of God? I've spent much of my life searching out, trying to understand the ways of God. I'm still doing that. I feel very similar to how Moses expressed it. If you're pleased with me, teach me your way so I may know you and continue to find favor with you. See, God knew Moses' name, but that wasn't enough for Moses. He didn't want to be on a first-name basis with God. He wanted to know God's ways. He wanted to know God. He wanted to have intimacy with God. That's the cry of my heart. I want intimacy with God. I've known way too much of the devil and his ways. I've known way too much of my own ways. Now I just want to know the ways of God. I want to know the ways of God so that I can please Him, that I could know Him. We all know some of God's ways. We know back in Exodus, the 20th chapter, God laid down quite a few of His ways. One of His ways is that He doesn't want you to have any other gods. He doesn't want you or me to turn to anyone else. He wants us to turn to Him because He is jealous for our love. Have you ever been jealous for someone's love? I can remember many times in school when I was just a kid, and in my heart, I would just love some little girl. I was too shy to talk to her. I'd talk to her in my mind, in my heart. Oh, but I loved her dearly. I'd do whatever I could for her. I remember in high school, strangest thing happened. A new girl came to the high school. And I tumbled head over heels in love with her. She could sing. And she was going to sing for the Christmas party for the school. And I decided to ask her for a date. So I asked her and she said yes. Her name was Sandra. She said yes. And so I accompanied her. She accompanied me to this concert, this Christmas concert. And they always had a big Christmas tree on the stage for this Christmas concert. And if you wanted to, you could purchase a gift for someone and have it put under the tree. And then at the end of the program, they would call off the names of the people that had gifts under the tree, and runners would bring them to whoever it was that had received that gift. The only requirement was you could not put your name on the gift. It had to be an anonymous gift. So I knew that no one would be buying this beautiful high school kid a gift, and I decided I was going to, and I didn't have very much money, but I saved, and I went down to the store, and I bought her a bottle of Chanel No. 5 perfume, and I wrapped it carefully, and I put it under the tree with her name on it, and she sang beautifully that wonderful Christmas song, All of My Favorite Things. And I loved it, and I was just totally in love with this beautiful young woman. Of course, I was shy. She lived in the village, and I was attending a boarding school. And so after the program was over, she was very delighted with her Chanel No. 5. She didn't ask if I had purchased it for her, if I was the one. She just loved that somebody had thought of her. And of course, I didn't tell her. I was planning to wait until I returned from Christmas holiday. And so I didn't ask her for another date that night. I was too shy. I just enjoyed her that night. We went to our separate dorms, and she went to her home in the village. And we separated the next day, scattered all over the country to our homes. When I got back from Christmas holiday, the first thing I wanted to do was ask her for a date. And there was a man on campus, a student, that I had a great deal of hatred for. He was the son of the principal, and he was extremely arrogant. And when I had first come to the school, he had spit on me and called me names because of the way I was dressed. I was dressed in bib overalls instead of the short overalls that everybody else was wearing. He called me a stupid farmer and some other names and cussed at me. Then I found out who he was, and I was very upset, but I couldn't beat him up because he was the principal's son. Well, I discovered that he had come and asked this woman for a date during the Christmas holiday, and she had gone with him, and things had gone very well, and now they were what we called back in high school, going steady, and she was wearing his watch. I was green with jealousy. I was so angry. The person that I loved had been stolen away from me, and that by an enemy. Now, please, if we can have these kinds of feelings in our heart, imagine how God feels when the devil steals you away from him. One of God's ways is that he is a jealous God. He is very desirous of our love, and he doesn't want anybody else coming and playing with our emotions. He doesn't want anybody else coming and stealing away our hearts. He's a jealous God. That's one of God's ways. If you don't understand the ownership feeling that God has, you will make him quite upset with you. And he will be quite distant from you. Now, he also says he doesn't like his name to be misused. He doesn't like you to use his name in a cheap or tawdry way. He doesn't like it when somebody says, "I'm a Christ follower," while they're a follower of the world. That's misusing the name of God. He doesn't like it when you claim to love him and then love the world. That's misusing his name. When you say, "I'm a Christian and I belong to Jesus and I serve him," but in truth, you serve yourself. You don't trust him. You grumble and complain against him. You grumble and complain and play like you're a victim. He doesn't like that. Makes him mad. Or remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. Remember the time that he's asked you to set apart for him. Surprise? God wants time with you. Did you know that? This morning I was, as I said, in the prayer closet, and I began reviewing some of the passages of Scripture that I'm sharing with you, and suddenly the Holy Spirit came. How do I know? I know God. There was a peace that was beyond me that settled in the studio. There was a tingling in the air. There was a sense of aliveness. In my spirit, there were ideas and thoughts that just began to come unbidden to my heart. He unfolded for me today what he wanted me to share with you. The Spirit of God came with power. He wants that time with me, and He wants that time with you. He doesn't want you giving all of your time to other people and other things. He's jealous. He wants you to come and spend time with Him. I remember when my wife was alive, before Jan died of cancer, she would come to me sometimes and say, "Ray, we need a joy break." And I would laugh because I knew exactly what she meant. She meant, "You've been working too hard and you haven't been spending quality time with me, and I need some time with you. Just let's go take a walk, or let's go get a cup of coffee, or let's just do something together. Let's get in the car and go for a ride." And so off we'd go. And I would be able to have time with her to talk with her and find out what was on her heart, what was disturbing her, or what she was hungry for, what she was concerned about. I always wanted to know what her thoughts were. I was jealous for my wife's thoughts, and I would often say to her, "Sweetheart, what are you thinking?" Now, I knew her so well that I could often tell before she even spoke what she was thinking about, but I still wanted her to tell me in her own words what she was feeling and what she was thinking. Why? Because I loved her. I loved her. Jesus wants to be like that with you. We talk about prayer, but did you know all prayer is opening your heart up to God as to a friend? It's just sharing with God what's in your heart. It's opening your heart for Him to see, unbidden, everything that's in your heart. What would happen today if you went into the prayer closet and you opened your heart to God and you didn't hide anything, you didn't close any of the doors in your heart? You just opened the doors wide and you let Jesus come in and you said, "Jesus, come in and see all that's in my heart." Would He be pleased by what He finds in your heart? Or would He find some room locked? And if He unlocked that door, would He find bitterness and anger in there? Would He find lust? Would He find ambition? Would He find religiosity with no presence of the Holy Spirit? What would Jesus find in your heart? I tell you, as I opened my heart wide to Him this morning, and I just said, "Jesus, my heart is yours. I am totally given to you. I hold nothing back from you. Come and look at every part of my heart and know me. And could I know you?" And He began to open His heart to me. And He began to talk with me about what He wanted me to say today. And then it was time to go get ready, and I had to break that time with Him. He knew why. I had to come and do what He wanted me to do on the radio today. But do you understand, when I leave here, I want to go back. I want more time with Him. I am hungry in my heart for more time with Him. Someone this last week referred to me as a nice person. And I said to them, "Please, don't ever refer to me again as a nice person." Do you know what the word "nice" means? It's an old English word. Actually, it's an old French word, but in the old English, "nice" means foolish or stupid. In the old French, and that's where it originally came from, was old French, it meant simple, silly. The Latin word for nice meant ignorant or incapable. I said, please, don't call me nice. Call me hungry. Call me eager. Call me Christian. Don't call me nice. Do you understand what I'm saying to you today? Jesus wants us to know his ways. He wants us to understand who he is. He wants us to know him. Do you know Jesus Christ? Do you know his ways? Do you understand what his heart is about? Have you grieved him? Have you just been a talker and not a walker? Do you understand? God wants people who won't just talk. He wants people who will walk. I lost my mouse. And we have a caller, so I'm going to take a caller. Hi, Chris. What would you like to share today?
Hello, brother. Just wanted to, of course, always thank you for such a wonderful broadcast every single day. I just wanted to comment. I'm laughing because you said, obviously, being called nice.
We suddenly lost him. Chris, I'm sorry we lost you. You got disconnected, but call me back. We have a few minutes, and I'd love to talk with you. Our number is 877-534-0780. And while we're waiting for Chris's call to get back, let me give you some information. You can go to nationalprayerchapel.com. That's nationalprayerchapel.com. And we're streaming this video live on air. Or there are podcasts, and you're welcome to download the podcast, subscribe to them, have them downloaded your iPhone or your iPod. Or you can just listen on your computer. I also want to invite you to come and worship with the National Prayer Chapel. We worship on Sunday at All Saints Anglican Church in Woodbridge, Virginia. It's right next to the Hilt Memorial Chapel. It's located on Gideon Drive. We meet on Sunday at 12 noon for prayer. At 12:30, we begin praise and worship. And you're welcome to come. If you want to know Jesus, that's what the National Prayer Chapel is all about. That's the deal. We want to know Jesus, and we want to be held accountable, and we want to walk faithfully before him. We also meet on Tuesday evening. On Tuesday evening, we meet at 6:30 to 7:30, and we just pray. At 7:30, we have a few songs in praise and worship, and then usually a brief exhortation on the scripture. And then we go directly into the actual practice of walking out the Christian faith. And you're welcome to come and walk with us. I know there are many of you listening to this broadcast who aren't going to any church. Or if you are, many of you are in churches that are totally devoid of the Holy Spirit. Come and be with the people who are very aware of the presence of the Holy Spirit. Distance should not be an issue. We have people who drive from Frederick, Maryland. We have people who drive from all around the D.C. metro area, Prince George's County, Prince William County, Fauquier. I mean, you name it, we have people driving from all over. Why? Because they want to hear a word that will convict their heart of sin and help turn their steps toward heaven. If that's the cry of your heart, then come. Now, once again, we meet at the All Saints Anglican Church in Woodbridge, Virginia. It's on Gideon Drive, right next to the Hilton Memorial Chapel. If you go to nationalprayerchapel.com, you will find there the directions to drive to the National Prayer Chapel. I invite you to come. Now, we're almost out of time, and I'd like to spend the last minutes of this broadcast just praying for you, please. Oh, Lord Jesus, we're never going to make it into the kingdom of heaven without your Holy Spirit coming and breaking down the walls, breaking down the rebellion by the power of the blood, Jesus, you shed on Calvary. I ask, Lord, that you would ignite a fire in the heart of your people, that they would seek after you, that they would open their hearts to you and invite you to come in and examine every part of their life. And anything that they find or that you find that is displeasing, would you convict them of that and ask them to cut it off and expel it? Lord, there's a work of cleansing that must take place. We have been talkers and not walkers. Lord, we have walked in wickedness. I beseech you today, Jesus, by the power of your Spirit, would you come and bring revival in the heart of every person listening to this broadcast? Lord, we want to know your ways, that we could walk with you, that we could be pleasing before you, that we could be shown your favor. Lord, I beseech you today, come and do your work in your people, lest we be cast away. Lord, we do not want to be like the children of Israel who always grumbled and murmured and would not believe you and lusted after the things of Egypt and after the things of darkness. Lord, change our hearts. And Lord, I just want to say to you today, I love you and I trust you. And I don't understand what's happening in the church today, except that its heart has been stolen away by the enemy. I ask you, Jesus, would you redeem your church? Would you restore your people? Whatever it takes. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. I'm Ray Greenlee. I pastor the National Prayer Chapel in Woodbridge, Virginia. I'll talk to you soon. God bless you.
To him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory.